And express yourself. Right, we're going to talk lost Top of the Pops now. We've got Chris Perry on the line from the BBC in Birmingham. So he likes it if we play him on with this little jingle.
Retro TV.
And now, from Norwich.
Charlie and I were at the back.
If you can't swim, ask about lessons at your local swim bar.
And it's over to Tony for tonight's gamble.
As you can see, it's very useful indeed, having arms as long as Mr. Tickle's.
What's the bonus catch for us?
Zebedee arrived. Time for bed, I think.
I am a beaten old Hector.
Oh, it's a marvellous place, this recording studio. All those dials and tape machines and turntables.
Boom, boom, Chris.
Absolutely. I love that intro. It's probably better than anything I could say.
Right, we're talking long-lost performances of Top of the Pops. So am I right in thinking, Chris, that three episodes have turned up?
Not complete episodes, but bits of episodes. When I was here last, about a month ago, wasn't I? And I was talking about 11 seconds of the Beatles turning up in Mexico. Well, someone contacted us afterwards and said, oh, 11 seconds, is that the best you can do? I've got at least a minute of it. And this led us to this gentleman up in Barnsley who'd been taping Top of the Pops in 1966. He'd done various editions. They're not complete editions, but there's a good 10, 11, 12 minutes there of some really fantastic performances.
Wow. Now, I've got a list of the performances in front of me, but Bob, my producer, said we've got no clips to play because, am I right in thinking this is film only and there's no audio?
That's right. I mean, even if you'd had some audio, you wouldn't have had much exciting to play because in June 1966, Top of the Pops was miming to records anyway. So I actually said to Bob, your producer, it doesn't matter what you play because the record will sound identical to whatever Top of the Pops broadcast.
So, is someone going to put some sound to these clips?
It's already been done. If you had been at our event...
Well, you never invite
Saturday.
Me. You have all of these great events. You've not ever invited me to one.
Well, you're welcome to any of them. I publicise it highly. People like your friend Richard, could get all our publicity. So I'm very surprised no one told you. It was all over the news. We were on BBC Midland Today, ITV Central, Radio WM, BBC Breakfast.
Funnily enough, I don't watch news. Chris, I don't watch BBC Midlands Today or listen to BBC West Midlands.
I thought you might do BBC Breakfast, though, or the BBC 1 o'clock news. Yeah. I thought you might have got to those. So never mind, Alex. You poor
Okay,
thing.
So... The sound has been added to the clips, yeah?
It has indeed. This was 8mm film. The guy was filming, and it was silent anyway. So we have to slow it down, lip sync it up. We've done a lot of cleanup, and in fact, I have to say, we're still doing more cleanup to it because the clips will probably get seen again at some point, looking even better than they are. But it was brilliant actually to have 300 people there on Saturday watching these clips with David, the guy who'd filmed them, who hadn't seen them since 1966, and he was genuinely blown away actually by how good quality they were and how good they sounded.
How good then are they and how good would they be? Because, I mean, you said 8mm, did you? And 16mm's better than 8mm, isn't it?
Yes, that's very true. I mean, 8mm was the kind of home format of the day. But of course, nowadays, with the modern technology of being able to scan things at HD and 4K, you can improve it enormously. The biggest problem you have is what's called the frame refresh, where you kind of get the disparity between the TV screen you're filming and the actual kind of camera you're using, which creates a kind of line, if you like, that goes down the screen. And we had that on the film on Saturday. But I have to say, our technical boffins have been at work ever since then, and they've actually found a way around this, so now we've found a way to actually get rid of that refresh, so in future when people watch it, they'll have no idea at all it came off the telly. It will look exactly as it did in 1966.
So these are three clips. Now, we know that two of these episodes are top. So these are three different episodes and clips from them. We know that two of these episodes were actually introduced by Pete Murray. So here's the challenge for you. All right, get a lip reader to tell us what Pete Murray is saying in the links, and then get Pete Murray to revoice the links, and then you've got it more or less complete.
except, of course, he didn't actually... Well, actually, there are a couple of bits of Pete Murray very briefly kind of standing there waving his arms, but the bits the guy filmed were the bands. So you've got the Troggs and the small faces and people like that. So in the best you can get out of Pete Murray is probably him going,
Right, OK. Well, I think he'd be probably happy to do that. So now what happens to them? Do you now send them back polished to the BBC? And if so, do you bill the BBC for cleaning them? What happens to them now?
Well, that's a very interesting question. I mean, we always return things for free. That's what Kaleidoscope do. So we will send back those very nicely polished bits to the BBC, who probably will then, hopefully, at some point, find somewhere to show them, and hopefully they will make some money off the copyright of them. Sadly, we don't get any money at all for them, and that's just the way of the world. I mean, it is what it is. And we're sitting on over probably 100 lost Top of the Pops performances now, including the ones we found earlier in the year of people like Rod Stewart and Elton John and T-Rex. And you know what, Alex? It is incredible that there is absolutely zero interest from the broadcasters. I mean, not even Apple have been bothered to be in touch about this latest Beatles fine. It is quite disappointing that, despite the fact that I have told the world and his aunt about these things now, you know, nobody seems interested, not even his aunt. Only you and I are interested, Alex.
Well, I don't believe that. I believe the people listening to this are really interested in these fines. And I find that very, very hard to swallow, because this is part of our history. These are, I said this on the radio the other day, and I said it sounds a bit gushy, but this is the soundtrack to our lives. And you've got the pictures to go with this. And millions of people would have watched in 1966, on the 17th of November, the Spencer Davis Group doing Gimme Some Lovin'. And also in 66, the Troggs, Dave D, Dozy, Beaky, Mick and Titch, Dusty Springfield, Gene Pitney, the Hollies, Ike and Tina Turner, the Shadows, the Small Faces, My Mind's Eye, Tom Jones, Cliff Richard and the Shadows, and the Beatles and Paperback Writer. And I'm sure there are hundreds of thousands who would enjoy watching these again.
Oh, I absolutely agree with you. I think the actual, you know, the fans of the music, the fans of the bands who are sitting listening to us now, would be crying out to get a programme onto, you know, any TV channel to actually show some of these again. And I would support that 100%. I'm truly baffled as to why, you know, record companies like BMG and Universal and Apple, despite us being told about them, have shown really no great interest in them whatsoever. I don't understand it, Alex.
No, nor do I. So, I mean, this is a real find. Did the guy know he had these in his loft for years and years and years and think no one would be interested, or had he just found, rummaging around or maybe moving house, this stuff?
Well, he knew he got the Beatles bits. He could remember actually doing the Beatles bits when he was 14, and he's now well up into his, you know, late 60s, early 70s or whatever. And he knew he'd still got the Beatles up in his attic, but he had forgot that he'd actually been filming other bits as well. He'd got, you know, it's quite ironic. When you transfer the film Raw, you see bits of Family Weddings and bits of Sheffield Wednesday groups in interspersed with bits of Top of the Pops, because the guy was obviously filming other things apart from just Top of the Pops. But he'd sat on them really for a long time, kind of hoping, I suppose, above hope, that maybe one day Apple would come knocking and offer him a vast amount of money for them, even though Apple didn't know he got them, of course. But he kind of hoped, I suppose, one day it might be a pension for him. And then eventually, he talked to his daughter, and his daughter said, look, it would just be fantastic for these things to be seen again. And his daughter was so proud of him on Saturday. She sat there watching them with him, and she thought it was magical, she did, that he'd brought so much happiness to people. So, you know, I really do hope that people making music documentaries out there and people commissioning music programmes out there will actually think about, you know, putting together some sort of missing believed wipe style documentary about pop stuff. That would be fantastic.
I think if you look at the BBC, there are so many different arms to the BBC, so many different legs to the BBC, that maybe not the right people in the BBC know that these exist. And I think the trouble with, for you, the challenge really for you is Kaleidoscope are very, very well respected by many, but not enough people. And if they just, what you need is you need TV executives to come to you and say, look, what have you got? What can we use? And also, I mean, I would imagine that, you know, the painstaking work you've done cleaning these up has cost time and money, and you should be reimbursed for that as well.
Well, I mean, it's a very interesting debating point there. I mean, in the last 2 years, 3 years, in fact, we have pitched these ideas of kind of lost music programmes through Shiver Television, through Phil McIntyre Television, through wall-to-wall television, that they have all pitched kind of lost type shows. And I have to say the response, I've been to Mark Cooper, the head of BBC Music, put the list in front of him, and his reaction was, well, these groups aren't big enough to get an audience, and it would cost us too much money to make it. So it's been quite deflating to have so many commissioners turn these things down, you know, largely on the grounds that they aren't kind of exciting enough for them. And yet, I have to say, archive programmes get really good audiences, you know, so it's quite short-sighted, I think, but hey-hey.
I think one of the problems is, and I'm not talking on behalf of the BBC, I'm just talking as a viewer who loves television and radio, that maybe 10 years ago BBC 4 would have been all over you to make documentaries about this kind of stuff, but of course there's been cutbacks in the BBC, and BBC 4 aren't making the number of programmes they were making, so maybe it's a funding issue.
Yes, and I think that could be true, because making music programmes is more expensive, because you have to get, you know, the record companies cleared and get the bands cleared, as well as just clearing the footage. But it's been done in the past, and there's no great reason why it can't be done again. There's a whole worldwide market out there, and I think it's quite interesting that when we, a couple of weeks ago, you know, announced that we'd found the Elton John performance of Rocket Man, which was literally just a few weeks before the premiere of the film, we had a very nice message from Elton John's kind of PR agent that came back through the BBC saying, you know, it's lovely to know it's been found, but then nothing. When we actually said to the record company, well, do you want to do something with this then, on a download maybe, or release it at the same time as the Rocket Man film? Absolute silence. Mm. Not a word.
I would imagine you're just not getting to the right people, because there are so many people involved in Elton John's world. I'm sure if Elton found out about it, he'd be jumping all over it. Well, look, Chris, it's always lovely to speak to you. When is your next event that you're not going to invite me to?
Well, the next one, which I'm not going to invite you to, is a few months in advance. It is the 7th of September, so I'm sure we'll speak before then. It's about the Muppets. We have the Muppets coming on the 7th of September. You two can come and meet Muppet puppeteers and meet original Muppets and other puppets as well. It has nothing to do with Lost TV, really, at all. It's just a lot of fun around the history of television. But I'm sure we will find more things before then, and I'm sure we'll speak before then, Alex, as well.
OK, so people just say, hop online. They can find all of the Kaleidoscope details there, and they can find out what you're events are
we're at tvbrain.info. It's always there.
All right, thank you very much, Chris Perry. Always nice to talk to you from Kaleidoscope. They do such important work. So the clips that have been found: the Beatles, Paperback Writer, Cliff Richard and the Shadows, Cinderella at the London Palladium. It's a rehearsal. That would be interesting to watch. Tom Jones, The Green Green Grass of Home, The Small Faces in My Mind's Eye, The Shadows, The Dreams I Dream, Ike and Tina Turner, and a promo film for A Love Like Yours. The Hollies and Bus Stop, Gene Pitney, Nobody Needs Your Love, Dusty Springfield, Going Back, Dave D, Dozy, Beaky, Mick and Titch, Save Me, The Troggs, Any Way That You Want Me, and the Spencer Davis Group, and Gimme Some Lovin'.
Well, my tongue grew to mother, now my feet love the breeze.
The Spencer Davis Group and Gimme Some Love.